Got the club going up on a Tuesday. Got your girl in the cut and she choosy. Club going up.
Tonight, our fearless leader steps down. Dennis J. Murray is stepping down as president of Marist College. We can't wait to tell you who might replace him.
Later, world travelers beware. The Marist campus in Florence is closing down. Girls are frantically taking pictures by landscapes and posting travel quotes on Facebook. Why? The answer just ahead.
Plus, Miley Cyrus takes the high road, the highest road of all. She's leaving her celebrity life for the convent. Stay tuned for details about Sister Cyrus.
Hello, and welcome to the MCTV Weekly News Update. Today is April 1st, 2015. I'm Dylan Gordon.
And I'm Erin Murtha.
The hunt for a new president at Marist College is on. As earlier this year, DJ Murray, you can download his mixtape at www.ifyou'rereadingthisimnotpresidentofmaristcollegeanymore.com, announced he will be retiring in 2016. The next question is, who will replace him? Well, of course, there's been plenty of speculation. Sources inside the Marist executive branch, yes, we have those, shut up, have been pinpointed three potential frontrunners. The first is Waldo from Where's Waldo? Think about it. We're always asking where he is. Now we'll know. The second is that Filipino Sodexo guy from the cabaret. He keeps it real, so who else do you want overseeing priority points and the building of the science building? The third candidate is, surprisingly enough, myself. Yes, I am running, and I think an incomplete communications major is enough to run an entire university. I mean, how hard can it be? I just got to give a couple speeches and say out to people around campus, right?
And now you may be asking, what is DJM going to do with all of this free time? How will he ever be able to return to normal civilian life? Well, he won't, and he has no plans to. DJM has announced his candidacy for the 2016 presidential election. He has big plans for the future of America, and he has pulled out all of the stops. America's new national animal will be the red fox, and America will be affectionately referred to as the foxhole. Our national currency will be changed to thrifty cash because we seem to have an abundance of that laying around. Additionally, John Gildard will be running as his VP because America always needs to be prepared for snow and half-assed iPhone emails. Bumper stickers are available at the bookstore.
So what do you think about this?
I'm going to vote for you.
Vote for me?
Yeah, for president of Marist College.
All right, I like that. I also think that President Murray is going to do pretty well as president of the United States. I think he has a good chance against the likes of, like, Ted Cruz and the rest of those people.
I think so, too. I think he has good charisma. I mean, I think he can, you know, bring some life back into the, yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Back to you, Erin.
If you've been on Instagram lately, you may have noticed a lack in particularly white girl-esque photos. This is no coincidence. As of yesterday, Marist has decided to shut down its Florist campus due to a decrease in funding. Marist students are heartbroken over the loss of opportunity to explore culture in different areas of the world. However, President DJM argues that being drunk in every country in Europe does not count as cultural immersion. And, to mend some wounds, plans to donate funding for Darby's and Union to put up some pictures of Europe around the bar. He says that it's, quote, basically the same thing. The funding saved from the Florist campus is expected to go towards things much more critical to Marist Educational Foundation, such as whole wheat bagels and pristine landscaping.
Get your baseball bats and hammers ready. Looks like the zombie apocalypse may be coming our way sooner than we think. It's been rumored that the Hudson Rivers Hospital across the street from Marist may have science students performing experiments on cadavers in the hospital's morgue wing. Many people attending the hospital have described hearing muffled groans and the sound of shambling coming from the floor below the regular hospital areas. One Poughkeepsie resident described seeing what she described as a zombie, and I'm not talking about the college student suffering from a horrible hangover. Marist officials are nervous that the so-called zombies could be a huge problem for the safety of the Marist community and the parking lots. Expect an email from John Gildard on the matter very early tomorrow morning.
Speaking of zombies, how about that weather out there? It's been kind of toasty recently. Rose Shannon has your details in her weekly highs and lows report.
Hey everyone, I'm Rose Shannon, and this is your weekly highs and lows report. While we have been spoiled with this beautiful weather, the same can't be said around the world. On Sunday, a 7.5 magnitude earthquake hit off the coast of the island of Papua New Guinea. Thankfully, there were no reports of damages or injuries. After the earthquake, threats of a tsunami quickly passed, before an even worse weather event could occur, a sharknado. According to local reports, the local shark community was none too pleased about the earthquake, or the news about a potential tsunami, and decided to take the revenge out on the Guineans. In Europe, on Monday and Tuesday, strong winds swept across the continent from Ireland to Germany. Wind gusts were so strong they threatened to down trees, cause power outages, and create hundreds of flight and train delays. Many schools across Europe had no choice but to cancel school both days, as they were afraid many young children would blow away in the wind during recess time, as this week is International Go Outside for Recess Week. Here in the Hudson Valley, our weather has been less extreme. The high for today was a fantastic 860 degrees, which tied today's record. I truly hope everyone dragged themselves out of the library, avoided all responsibility, and got a chance to spend some time outside at Marist Beach. That is, if you could find a spot. The low for today was negative 54 degrees, which is just 1 degree below the average temperature for this time of the year. The sun decided to sleep in today, rising at 11 a.m., and then decided it was done with Tuesday because, well, who isn't, setting at 4 p.m. Well, the beautiful weather may have taken the turn for the worse. With updates on the local weather, we now go to our own John Perna, reporting live from a little storm that's taking place right outside in our own backyard. Hey, John, how are the conditions on the Hudson? So hard. Okay.
Cool. That was...
Thanks, Rose. Right now I'm on the Hudson River. The winds have reached up to 69 miles per hour. Things have gone crazy down here. I've seen a handful of streakers, people running in horse masks, and I just witnessed a Loch Ness monster emerge from the river. To top that off, I'm pretty sure I saw the Norse god Thor ride down a lightning bolt and crash to the earth. The wind here sounds like screams I've only heard in my nightmares. I'm extremely horrified at the moment. I do not know whether I'm drenched from this rain or I just wet myself. It's gotten so bad, I decided to write my will, then go and get to my cameraman to return back to my family. Back to you guys in the studio.
A recent study done by the University of Georgia has shown that swans are now the second creature in the animal kingdom that mate for a few years, get scared of commitment and things, and learn to regret their decision. The study shows that swans, just like humans, will spend a few years with a significant other, then stupidly decide that they aren't ready to take things to the next level. After ending things, they will go about their lives taking on multiple partners to fill the void in their hearts. Then, just like the Homo sapien, they will greatly regret their decision, but find it's too late, as the other swan has moved on and is now very, very happy. So you think that you're the only one in the world dealing with this problem? Remember, you're not even the only one in your species with this problem.
Say goodbye to long hours of exercise in the gym and that horrific stuff called salad. A new Hollywood dieting craze is taking over the fitness and health industry. After a bad batch of spinach infected with the E. coli bacteria was distributed to stores around Hollywood, many consumers got violently sick with E. coli poisoning. However, instead of reacting negatively to their near-death experiences and sky-high hospital bills, E. coli victims were pleased to find that they had experienced a significant amount of weight loss. And in Hollywood, does anything else really matter? So replace your kale chips with some raw cookie dough and slightly undercooked chicken from your favorite fast food restaurant. Dramatic weight loss is right around the corner, you health guru, you.
Due to popular demand from the weight loss craze amongst college girls getting, quote, spring break or beach bod ready, Mara's favorites and only frozen yogurt shop Hoopla announced that they will be releasing some new figure-friendly changes to their menu. The new almond milk and soy-based yogurt is now offered in sautéed spinach, peas and carrots, and quinoa quencher. In addition, top off these healthy, tasty treats with some new toppings such as chia seed chips or a tomato paste drizzle.
Want to go to Hoopla after this?
I've been to Hoopla once and I like Hoopla, but the new weight loss ones make me feel a little eh.
Well, I mean, you do need to watch your weight. I wasn't gonna say anything, especially on camera, because it's embarrassing.
On some pounds,
but
so.
But you know, Hoopla diet, you should be okay.
Perfect.
You'll be ready by summer.
Thank you.
Maybe.
Beach bod ready.
Yeah. All right. Well, from Hoopla to hoops, it's time to see who is hashtag throwing like a girl.
That's right. Here's Matthew McConaughey. Okay. I mean McNamara with your weekly sports report.
Good evening, sports fans. Here's what's happening in the world of sports this week. With baseball season starting up, many experts are already stating that the Chicago Cubs might actually win the World Series this year, which would be a thrill for every fan except Gabe Longstocking, a 108-year-old Cub fan who vividly remembers the Cubs' last title in 1908. It was a thrilling time, said Longstocking. I had my first beer, had my first kiss, and watched the Cubs win the World Series. Best day of my life. The NHL has now implemented a new rule of removing the puck from the game of hockey. But here's the twist. We haven't actually told the players about it. But it'll sure be hilarious when they find out, said Davey Hockeystick, commissioner of the NHL. Fan polls have recently shown that hockey has become so watchable due to in-game fights and fast-paced skating, so the removal of the puck shouldn't make that big of a difference. The Phoenix Suns and Detroit Pistons ended in a 1,000-1,000 tie last night on their Space Jam-themed night. Suns guard Jason Sunglasses says his body felt possessed by a literal alien the entire game. With intergalactic aliens recently inhabiting parts of Los Angeles and Texas, this recent string of body invasions could have actually been a ploy by the league to actually make the game like the actual movie Space Jam. Michael Jordan was not available to once again defeat them. And finally, the world of golf saw a huge accomplishment today as Johnny Putter hit the ball so high in the air that it hit an actual eagle, which plummeted to the ground, landing into hole to get Putter an actual double eagle. When asked afterwards about its accomplishment, Putter simply responded, "Yeah, That's exactly what I was trying to do.
A ghost named Shelley, who haunts a freshman dorm at Marist, has been wreaking havoc once again. Students who attended an off-campus party Saturday night came back to find their house in Lower Fulton wrecked and teepeed. Yet they brushed it off since they were drinking and believed that they were seeing things. The next morning, they did a closer investigation of the house and realized that their microwave had been broken along with some plates, a chair, and their couch. The creepiest part of the story is that they found a note in their living room, on their living room wall, written in lipstick saying, "I'm still here, girls, and I know everything." The students reportedly lived in the dorm Shelley haunts freshman year, and all of them experienced similar occurrences before. Maybe Marist is a bit spookier than we once thought.
Every college student since the dawn of time has attempted to find a fail-proof hangover elixir. This fantastic feat has finally been achieved by Marist College sophomore Curtis Bronner in an attempt to rid himself of the terrible aches and pains plaguing him from a recent night in the town. Bronner said, quote, "I just walked down to the fridge, threw in some eggs, a half pint of chocolate milk, some old brownies we had laying in the fridge, and a whole onion from my housemate's fridge. I threw them in a blender and drank the drink. I didn't mean to use the ingredients, so maybe I was still kind of drunk, but the hangover completely disappeared." Students all over the country are now rushing to nearby Stop and Shops to grab the ingredients for this brand new life-saving liquid.
That was my onion.
What?
Curtis took my onion.
Are you mad?
Eh, I mean, it's for a good cause.
It is. Now you know how to cure a hangover.
I know, right? We can easily cure that hangover after a Saturday night.
Yeah, okay.
Now, you've all heard about the recent allegations surrounding Brian Williams' six-month leave of absence from NBC News.
Well, we recently received news that he won't be returning at all from his absence. He's actually been fired.
And guess who's been hired by NBC to take his place?
We have.
See you, suckers. We're off to the big times.
Peace.
I guess I'm filling in.
Hello.
Wow, this is weird.
How are you? What is your name?
I'm good. I'm Clancy.
Ah, Max. Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
Well, to continue with the news, during this weekend's sermon at Vatican City, Pope Francis called for the legalization of marijuana. Citing experts from across Snoop Dogg's neighborhood, the Pope insisted that the pot is, quote, like, totally the illest. He suggested to his followers that they embrace an open mind through the herb, saying, "I don't know, man. Maybe we're all just leaves trying to find our own tree of life." The sermon was cut short when Pope asked his clergy where the nearest Taco Bell was. Catholics left the sermon confused over the mental health of the Pope after his live mic picked up him finishing the sermon saying, "Dog bless," and, "Wait, when did my hat get so big?"
Party girl Miley Cyrus has decided to take a break from the spotlight and become a nun. She says, quote, "I'm trading in my high heels and designer purses for more important things, like Bibles and rosary beads. It is confirmed that she will not be allowed to take her maid and butler with her, which is an issue she's currently coping with. Her family fully supports her decision and believes that everything she has done up until now has prepared her for this moment. Cyrus leaves for the convent on April 25th.
Sorry.
Hold on.
Oh, yeah, we're back.
Thanks for the opportunity, though.
You're welcome. You can't do an interview drunk. For your next job that you go on, don't drink.
Do an interview drunk.
Go sober.
Terrible
Thank
idea.
You for that.
NBC didn't hire us.
I apologize.
Hashtag no new friends, you know.
Respectfully, screw you guys. I'm going to go hang out with the Pope.
That's fine. Go smoke with the Pope.
Where did we leave off?
I don't even know. How do you feel about not getting this?
I'm pissed.
Yeah, I really wanted that job.
I think we were qualified.
Look at the professionality
of this broadcast.
I know.
Whatever.
We're professionals.
You're lost.
I know. NBC could have used us.
Yep. Well.
Anyway.
That's their problem.
The Marist community has been discussing the construction of the new academic building located across Route 9, although many believe it is revamping their science department by creating a space for a new program. It turns out Marist is actually creating a safer environment for student nightlife. The Housing Department and Office of Safety and Security have been pushing for this since 2007, when they found a majority of students were going out to the middle of crime hotspots in the Poughkeepsie area while intoxicated. The new building will be a three-story nightclub, and students will be offered one free drink upon entry. The rest you can pay with for thrifty cash. So, whoever Shots are on whoever hasn't been to the cab this semester. All you need is your Marist ID to get in.
Tonight Show host Jimmy Fallon was seen walking out of a Manhattan Dunkin' Donuts this morning with a mysterious woman who looks significantly younger than him. According to our sources, the girl was, quote, a petite brunette wearing a floral dress and knee socks with large doe-like eyes. It's hard to determine whether the girl seen was with the real Jimmy Fallon or one of his recently created wax statues he performed with on his show last Thursday. Sources close to MCTV suggest that the girl may be interning for the show. We were not able to get any comments from Fallon's wife, Nancy Juvenon, on the incident.
Speaking of scandalous stars, our own Andrew Ogier is here with This Week in Entertainment. What's going on, Andy Poo?
Oh, hey there. I'm entertainment guru slash kind of a big deal here at MCTV, Andrew Ogier. You may be wondering why I'm dressed in my pajamas in front of a roaring Yuletide fire, and you also may be wondering why I'm drinking a glass of 1932 Paul Rogers Sir Winston Churchill champagne. Well, the obvious answer is that they didn't tell me what we were supposed to be doing today, so I just decided to do what I do every day. Plus, my interest in this silly news show fluctuates more than Drew Barrymore's day-to-day attractiveness. I even wore my sports pajamas this week just to show how much I secretly hate everyone. To that I say, salute. That hits the spot. Well, I guess there are a few things I could talk about this week, like how Kim Kardashian was compared to Amy Elliott Dunn from Gone Girl by her own brother Rob. Now Rob, referring to your sister as a psychopath is fair play. I personally think my sister is a mix between the worst aspects of Fergie and the best aspects of Freddy Krueger, but making comparison between these marriages is not cool. It's clear that Nick and Amy Dunn's marriage is far more real and loving than Kimye's will ever be, and that's an insult to those characters. Speaking of insulting characters, there's apparently a show on ABC Family called Pretty Little Liars, or as Brian Williams calls it, it's the handsome truth, I swear. They've been teasing viewers with the reveal of this A fellow, but does anybody really care at this point? I mean, my name starts with an A. You don't see me running around looking for clues like I live in a house with a blue dog and a thinking chair. Although this chair is pretty nice. Anyway, here's the one part of the week I do like, the weekend box office. In a stunning comeback, the 1997 comedy Zeus and Roxanne debuted in first place this week. The film, which stars Steve Guttenberg and chronicles the adorable freak of nature relationship between a dog and a dolphin, made $300 million this weekend, probably because the studios were paying people to sit down and watch the film after all of these years. But hey, if it gets you out of Kevin Hart, Will Ferrell shenanigans, then whatever. If you haven't seen Zeus and Roxanne, you're probably a communist at this point, and I have no words for you. This week sees the release of next installment of a popular franchise with a lot of emotion behind its release. I'm of course referring to Homeward Bound 3. How are these original animals still alive? Well, I should probably wrap this up. I have a baby signing and dog neutering joint event in about 5 minutes. You have a lot of duties as co-entertainment director, trust me. I'm Andrew Ogier, and to quote that hairy Portuguese kid from The Other Half, you stay classy, Marist.
Boo, and what's up, Marist? I'm Brianna Flynn, and if you're anything like me, you're still pretty disappointed with Nick Jonas for divorcing his family and breaking up the Jonas Brothers, and with Justin Timberlake for dragging the rest of NSYNC through the mud. Looking back, these things are forgivable, because Kevin Jonas has been really killing it as a solo act, and JT is now president of the United States. But there's one boy band mistake that has literally left the world in shambles and has everyone asking one question. What's up with Zayn? Unless you've been living under a rock, you've heard the nonstop crying of children and already know that Zayn Malik left One Direction last week. His decision was not only rude as hell, but it led to a rift in the natural world that left much of Europe uninhabited by human beings. Lucky for us, Poughkeepsie is safe, but not for long. I just received some breaking news about a potential fourth candidate to take over after President Murray. Snapchat blew up yesterday when Malik was spotted trying to sneak out of Marist in a campus ministry van after he met with Murray. I heard from a Sodexo employee who catered the top secret conversation that Zayn is staging a coup to overthrow Murray's position, though he'll be looking to adopt the title of king instead of president. His first order of business is derived from an ancient torture device known by parents across America. During the 15 minutes between classes, What Makes You Beautiful will be played on repeat over the entirety of campus. There will be no smiling at the ground after one day of that, and that's coming from someone who knows that song deserves a Grammy. Another proposed ruling is that every future SPC concert will feature Zayn singing the Marist fight song for 2 hours straight. For someone who left 1D to be a, quote, normal 22-year-old, becoming the king of Harvard on the Hudson seems like a pretty bold move. One thing we can thank him for is that he'll be likely replacing every Red Fox logo on campus with his face. No one can honestly complain about that. The rest of the band appears to be doing okay despite Zayn's ego trip. Liam Payne already recorded and sold 2 million copies of his debut solo album. Louis Tomlinson is slated to replace Shailene Woodley as Triss for the remaining 2 Divergent movies. Niall Horan is teaching a class on coping with loneliness. And Harry Styles is... Actually, was there ever a member of 1D named Harry Styles? That name doesn't ring a bell. Regardless, things are going to be changing a lot on campus soon, and I hope that we're all able to survive life under Zane's rule. As a very wise and talented group of high schoolers once said, we're all in this together. I'm Brianna Flynn, and that's what's up. Now, back to the studio.
Finally, tonight is the story of a girl. Her name was Lola. From West Philadelphia, born and raised, Shawty had them apple-bottom jeans and boots with the fur. Pretty woman, walking down the street, these boots were made for walking. I ain't say she a gold digger. Is it weird that her bra reminds me of a Katy Perry song? Just a city boy, born and raised in South Detroit. They took the midnight train to Georgia. He was a skater boy. She said, see you later, boy, because Stacy's mom has got it going on. Fathers, be good to your daughters, but it ain't no lie, baby, bye, bye, bye.
I couldn't have said it better myself. That was heavy.
It was heavy. That news was tough to say.
I mean, this is what true journalism is about. Hard-hitting,
seriously, people.
Breaking news.
Absolutely.
Yes.
And now we have a very special MCTV news report. Some of the material in this special report may be disturbing to those who are underdressed. Viewer discretion is advised. All of us at the MCTV Weekly News Update know Peter Malavenda as our hardworking, fearless director, but he also interns 2 days a week at Fox News in the heart of New York City. Or at least, that's what he wants you to think. This is a heartbreaking story of how addiction can tear a man apart. This is Undone Buttons, the Peter Malavenda story.
Peter interns in the city on Tuesdays and Fridays for his hustle on the Fox Business Channel. Something seemed fishy to us last week when Peter began to tell us how he thought Cecil's was really cool. But it is common knowledge that even people who work for Cecil don't think his mustache is cool. Naturally, we had to investigate this further. What we found is quite honestly appalling.
We called Fox News directory and found that there was no Peter Malavenda working there. In fact, Peter had not shown up to his regularly scheduled interview. We then cross-referenced Peter's credit card account with his to-do list that he shares with Marissa Ayudo and found that Peter's last few charges had gone to some of his favorite department stores. Our eyewitness accounts in the city followed Peter last week, and instead of going to his job like he said, Peter was going from department store to department store trying on different button-down shirts without buying them.
Peter tries on every color from every store, from orange to green to purple to polka dots. On certain occasions, Peter has been seen to try on women's button-downs, if only to feel the warm embrace of that specific type of shirt. It's hard to say why Peter tries these button-downs on or why each employee of each department store knows his face. Or why he goes by the name Ryan Clark when he says. Okay, well, we do know this for sure. Our crew.
Keep it together. Take a look at our various testimonies.
He once showed me his robe, his silk button down robe. He asked me to touch it.
Peter and I were once walking down the street and we saw a hobo wearing a button down that he didn't already own. And Peter paid him for the button down because it was something new.
Anytime Peter is not wearing a button down, I get a little concerned. I think we should call the National Guard.
Peter told me his favorite movie was Risky Business because he liked Tom Cruise's button down.
Once I asked Peter why he wore so many button downs, and then he punched me in the face.
I remember once at work, I saw Peter change his shirt 3 times. I really thought something was wrong.
Well, P-Drive's actually been wearing kind of these really big shirts, and they're kind of tight up around the neck, and I'm kind of worried about him. I don't know if he's just got regular T-shirts, but the college shirts are really doing him in.
Monday button down, Tuesday button down. It's very nice. It's different from what I've seen a lot of guys wearing on campus, meaning snapbacks and really low pants. So it looks very classy, very nice. So keep it up, Peter.
It's all he talks about. He had a family dinner, and I asked how it went. And he said he yelled at his grandmother because she doesn't own any button-downs. Like, let Grandma Malavenda be free.
Wednesday button-down, Thursday, button down. Friday, button down.
I mean, how many button downs can one person have? Scientifically proven, it's said that people who wear button downs are more likely to become a serial killer.
You know who else wears button downs? Jeffrey Dahmer, Whitey Bulger, Walter White.
Well, at first I wondered why Peter wasn't showing up to the media center every day. And then somebody told me he had some kind of internship, so I figured he must be doing pretty well for himself. But then I started hearing things, and now there's this whole button-down shirt thing. It's all very confusing. I'm starting to wonder who this Peter really is.
One time, I went shopping with Peter. He bought two button-down shirts. He left with more clothes than me.
I mean, me and Peter always go out, you know, singing karaoke every Monday. But then he started wearing these button-down shirts, and everything was still fine. But then one night we were there, and he's like, "Hey, I want to do this Little John song." I'm like, "Okay, that's fine." He goes out there and just throws, "Button down for what?" He has to stop.
When I first met Peter, I told him I like polos more than button-ups. And he hasn't talked to me since.
One time I saw Peter, and he was wearing a t-shirt, and I had a button-down on, and he made a switch. He made me change.
I recently went on a date with Peter. He came in a button-down shirt. Looked real nice, but he got some tomato sauce, you know, right on his sleeve, and he went home to change. Took him 3 hours before he came back. He couldn't decide which shirt to wear. I'm worried about him.
About 2 or 3 weeks ago, I took Peter out to a nice day in town, not telling him what was going to happen at the end of the day. I put him in my car. I took him down to the clinic to find him some help for wearing shirts. He knew what I was going to take him in for. He just started running. I couldn't get him, and that's the last time I tried to help him out.
Some of you may remember the infamous Middle Seats episode from the start of this year or semester, simply titled Cough, where American Sniper was reviewed. During the American Sniper review, Jake coughed through it the entire time. Everybody assumed Andrew and Jake were sick. That's not the case. The Middle Seats hosts were wearing particularly nice button-downs that day, and they were complimented on. Their director, being Peter, did not receive such compliments. What looked like to be sick was actually one of Peter's many poisons inserted into their drinks to simply demolish the show. I just hope you all see this before he does.
I don't know what he's thinking wearing those button-down shirts all the time. I mean, who is he trying to impress? Is he trying to impress me? Is he trying to impress Andrew, Brittany? We don't know.
So I've been friends with Peter Malavenda for about 4 years now, and I think maybe there are a handful of times I've not seen him in a button-up shirt. One time, we repainted the MCTV green screen, and I was like, oh man, here we go. First time I'm ever gonna see him in not a button up, like regular tee, normal shorts, like not looking as professional as he always does. I showed up that morning so excited, and then here we go. He walks in, khaki pants, blue button up shirt, and I'm like, hey, you know, you might get paint on that. You're supposed to wear your not good clothes. And he's like, yeah, well, this is my second favorite polo. I'm like, all right. So Peter Malavenda, you might need to step down your button-up game.
But I know what's up with Peter and the shirts. I'll tell you right now. You see, he's got all these shirts.
We're here for you.
He once showed me his robe.
Now, it's been a serious night of news here in Studio A, and we appreciate you tuning in. We know you have a lot of college news stations to choose from, so thank you for choosing MCTV.
On the chance you actually want to see more of us, follow our Instagram and YouTube pages. They're posted below. Until next time, I'm Erin Murtha.
And I'm Dylan Gordon. Later, haters.
It's just one of those days when you just can't seem to win. If things don't go the way that you guys plan, figure something else out. Those things.